The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, second chapter, text number 55, given by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded in the summer of 1966 in New York.
Prajahasidada kaman sarvana patha manogatan atmaneva atmana tushtaha sitapragna sadutyate. Now, we have been discussing for the last few days about a consciousness being dovetailed with the Supreme Consciousness. That is the perfection stage of life. We are at the present moment in our material conditions, we are manufacturing ideas and being baffled also, because it is the business of the mind to create something and again reject it. Mind will think of it, yes, let me do this. It will decide, oh, better not to do this. This is called sankalpa vikalpa, deciding and rejecting. And this is due to our unsteady condition in the material platform. But when we decide to act according to the Supreme Consciousness, at that stage there is no such duality that let me do it or let me not do it. No. There is only one thing. Let me do it. Let me do it. Because it is sanctioned by the Superior Consciousness. The whole Bhagavad Gita is based on these principles of life. Now the beginning, in the beginning of the Bhagavad Gita, the Arjuna, in the battlefield, he was perplexed whether to fight or not to fight. That was his problem. First of all, he thought that my cousin brothers, they have given me so much trouble. They have usurped my kingdom, so I must fight with them and retake my lost kingdom. That is determination. Again, when actually in the battlefield he saw his brothers and his friends, because it was a family quarrel, so in both the sides, all the friends and relatives, they join, either to this party or that party. But the duty is that Arjuna became compassionate. That why should I fight simply for the kingdom? How long I shall remain in the kingdom? Let me not fight. Let me not fight. I shall not fight. That was his decision. Because he was a devotee of the Lord. This good compassion came into his mind. With other party, they did not consider it. The other party was determined to fight. Now, Arjuna was hesitating, and therefore the Bhagavad Gita was explained. The Lord, first of all, tried to engage him in the battle in the ordinary way, and when he when it was not possible, and there was some argument between Arjuna and Krishna in favor and in against the fighting, but at last Arjuna decided that let me appoint Krishna the best amongst us to advise me what to do and what not to do. Then the Bhagavad Gita was begun. That is the history. You all already discussed it and you know it. Now, here the Supreme Consciousness, Krishna is Supreme Consciousness. And Arjuna is individual consciousness. About consciousness, I have explained several times that we are all consciousness, but we are not Supreme Consciousness. Supreme Consciousness is the Supreme Law. That we have to understand first. The Supreme Consciousness, we are consciousness undoubtedly, but we are not Supreme Consciousness. If we falsely claim that I am also the Supreme Consciousness, that will be a false claim. We are not actually the Supreme Consciousness. Qualitatively, we are one. Qualitatively, we are one. The Supreme Consciousness and my consciousness is qualitatively one. But quantitatively, the Supreme Consciousness is different from individual consciousness. Individual consciousness is limited, and the Supreme Consciousness is unlimited. That just like you can think of your consciousness within this body. Whenever there is something painful or something itching in any part of my body, I am conscious of it. I know it, where and how it is being done. I do not know how it is being done, but I know where it is. So that consciousness, as I am conscious in any part of my body, but I am not conscious of your part of my body. Therefore, my consciousness is limited. Similarly, you take the whole cosmic manifestation as the external body of the Supreme Consciousness. Therefore, Supreme Consciousness is, conscious of anything which is taking part in any part of the conscious the manifestation. And you'll find in the Bhagavad Gita that the Supreme Consciousness knows the past, present and future, but we are not conversant in that way, that I know the present, past and future. That is my deficit. Now, Arjuna declined to fight, and after hearing Bhagavad Gita, after understanding Bhagavad Gita, he agreed, yes, I shall fight. Yes. Krishna inquired, now I have explained to you everything about knowledge, about yoga, about fruitive activities, about devotional service, everything, all round Vedic wisdom I have explained to you. Now it is up to you to do or not to do. Mark this. The Supreme Lord can give us instruction. We are individual persons, individual living entities, infinite simas. The Lord is infinite and we are infinite simas. The Lord can advise the infinite simas to act in a certain way, but the infinitesimal, because it has got infinitesimal independence, it can reject it also. It can accept it or it can reject it. That is the clear declaration of the law. This is not for Arjuna only, but every one of us. Because we are all in the Arjuna's position. Arjuna is a living entity, individual living entity, so we are also, every one of us, a living entity and a supreme entity. Nitya Nityanam, in the Vedic literature, you will find this hymn. Nitya Nityanam Chetana Chetananam. Description of the Supreme. The Supreme is Nitya Nityanam. Nitya means eternal. So we are all eternal. That we have already discussed. We are soul, spirit soul. We are eternal. Na hannate hannamane sarire. We do not die after the annihilation of this body. We simply change the body just like we change our dress. But we are eternal. But because we are under the spell of this material energy, we do not take seriously that why I shall agree to change my body life after life. We have taken it as usual. Oh, this is our foolishness. We have got our eternal life, and in eternal life we have got immense measure of freedom, immense measure of power, almost equal to God. But we do not make any research in that part of our life. We are simply satisfied to have a little more of the necessities of our this present material life. Suppose I have got 100 millions of dollars. I think if I get 10,000 millions of dollars, then I shall get. This is our foolishness. You cannot be happy with any millions of dollars because you are not matter, you are spirit. You think like that I shall be happy. No. Just like, I'll give you one example. A diseased man, a suffering man, suppose he has got a severe headache. Now he sometimes thinks, oh, I'm suffering. If this, instead of headache, if there would have been some other pain in the hand or feet, then I would have been glad. Oh. It is like that. Our thoughts are like that. You don't want to get rid of the pain. There is another very good example. Of course, that is not in your experience, but it is in our India, we have got experience that on the river side, the boatman drags the boat with a rope. Have you got any experience like that here in America? I don't think you have. The boat is in the middle of the river, and there is a big log in the middle of the boat, and that log is tied with a rope, and that rope is snared by the boatman, and the boat goes in the middle of the river. Now, while passing on the bank of the river, there are so many things which pains his soul. So he is thinking that when I shall be a very rich man, then I shall cover this bank of the river with soft pillows, so that when I shall go over the pillows dragging this boat, I shall have no pain. Now, our position is like that. That the foolish boatman, thinking that when I shall be a very rich man, still I shall be pulling on this business. He does not know that if I at all become a rich man, then where is the necessity of my pulling this boat in this way? So similarly, we want to be happy in the same way. That when I shall be able to cover the whole world with cushions and soft pillows to travel over it, then I shall have no pain of watching like this. This is our plan. So this flag has to be rejected. The Lord said that your flag, so many flags, foolish flags, you should reject. Prajapati. Now, he says, what? Arjuna inquired that what is the sign of a person who has already adopted his consciousness with the Supreme Consciousness? Sita Prajna. Sita Prajna means steady. Steady in consciousness. So, what are the signs? Now, those signs are being explained by the Lord like this. That Prajahati Jada Kaman Sarvan Pathu Manogatan. Now, we plan like that boatman. For our happiness, we make multi-plans. That I shall do this, then I shall be happy. If I shall have it, then I shall be happy. In this way. But all, we do not know that I am pure consciousness. Any amount of my plan on this bodily conception of life, I will never be happy. He does not know it. He does not know it. He simply makes plans. You see? Because the platform on which we are standing, that platform itself is tottering. It's tottering. You cannot make it soft, tottering. This body, we have already discussed, all the miseries of our life, it is due to this body. Matras parsasya kaunteya sitosna sukudukkhada. Matras parsasya, all the distress and happiness that we feel in this material world, that is due to this skin, this body. Otherwise, the things as they are neither miserable nor source of happiness. The example is given just like water. Water, now in this season, this summer season, you will find very pleasant. The same water, in the winter season, it becomes pinching. So water as it is, neither pinching nor the source of pleasure, but it is due to this body. Under certain circumstances, it feels pleasure, and under certain circumstances, it feels distress. Though pleasure and distress, these dual forms of our existence is going on. Now, if we want to transcend above this material plan, then we will have to completely reject the bodily conception of life. We have to stand on the spiritual consciousness of life. That is being taught. The whole theme of Bhagavad Gita is like that. That we have to stand on the spiritual consciousness of life. And what is the spiritual consciousness of life? Now, some philosophers, just like Shankaracharya, there are many philosophers in the world. I mean, we may cite some of the authorities, just like Lord Buddha, then Shankaracharya, then Ramanujacharya, Lord Chaitanya. They are all big stalwart authorities. They are giving different views. Lord Buddha's view is that you can be happy only when you are free from this consciousness. Lord Buddha says that consciousness is the production of this combination of matter. So therefore, if you dismantle this material body, then there will be no consciousness, and thus there will be no feeling of distress or happiness. That is called Nibbana. Stopping the feelings of, it is just like a patient suffering from some disease, and the doctor gives him some pill so that he dies and there is no more feeling. Oh, then he says it is all right. If by stopping feeling like that, Doctor, my son is having 107 degrees temperature. All night I stop it, give him some injection poisoner. This child dies. Now there is no fever. Now, the father says, my child does not move. Oh, whether this fever is stopped or not. Yes, there is no fever also. That's all right, my business thing. That sort of foolish doctor will not do. We should not stop consciousness. No. Secret of philosophy. If my consciousness is stopped altogether, then what do I gain? That means my death. My whole existence finished. No. Then comes, I am shortly giving the substance of different philosophy. Then comes Shankaracharya preaches that no, you are the consciousness only. You are the consciousness only, and this body is false. Brahma Sattva Jagan Mithya. The Mithya means false. So, you should always know that I am Brahma, or the consciousness, and you should always reject that I am not this body. That is another slogan. Now, suppose if I think for years together that I am consciousness, I am consciousness, I am consciousness, do you think you shall be happy? Simply by understanding that I am not this body, I am consciousness. Will that help you? That is also not help you. Because if you simply theoretically say that I am not this body, and because your consciousness is now attached to the body, the consciousness is always active, so the consciousness must act to the body, and therefore your senses, you have to gratify your senses, certain. That is a real philosophy. You see, you cannot stop consciousness acting. It is very simple thing to understand it. Just think over that the activity of my body is due to my consciousness. I am speaking because I am conscious that I am speaking. You are hearing because you are conscious that you are hearing. As soon as this consciousness is gone, neither you can hear, neither I can speak. So any activity, either hearing or speaking or moving or eating or seeing, anything. But we have got different senses. We are active. Active means we are active with our senses. Mind is the central point of activitizing the senses. And that is our life. Life means the acting of the senses. And that beyond that mind, there is consciousness. See, if consciousness is gone, then what remains? Nothing remains. Therefore, you cannot simply by thinking that I am consciousness, that will not also solve your problem. You have to engage your consciousness in the matter of the Supreme Consciousness. You cannot keep your, just like, I'll give you one example, a naughty boy creating some mischievous thing. The father calls him, my dear boy, can you do this? Yes, father, I can do it. So he turns his attention from that mischief machine to something good. Because they want to be active. The children, they want to be active. You cannot stop them. You cannot say that stop and sit down here. Now he can artificially can do by the fear of the father or the mother, he can sit down for a moment. No. But that is not possible. You must give him some engagement. Good engagement. I have got my personal experience. My eldest son, when he was about 2 years old. Very much naughty. Always doing some mischief. So my friends who used to visit me, he would call my son. His name was Potter. Potter, if you sit down for 1 minute silently, I'll give you this thing. So the boy fell. He could not sit down even for 1 minute. So that is not possible. This is the nature. How can you stop your consciousness working? That is not possible. So I got to think that stop consciousness altogether. That is also not perfect. And I got to accept simply consciousness, that I am consciousness without any conscious engagement, that is also not perfect. You have to understand that you are consciousness, not this body. At the same time, you have to engage your consciousness to the supreme activity. Unless you do that, your life will not be perfect. So Lord Sri Krishna says that Prajahati Jada Saman Sarvan Patho Manogatan Atmani Eva Atmana Santushya Sita Pragga Tadachyate Sita Pragga. Sita Pragga means one is steadily situated in the platform of consciousness. Prajna means consciousness and Sita means steadily fixed. Only that you haven't got to create mental concoction to become happy. See, you have simply to dovetail yourself with the supreme will. There will be activities. Because your consciousness cannot be inactive, but there will be activities. That activity will be standard and without any mistake and without any flaw. Because it is dictated by the Supreme. That's like a child is giving instruction to write A. So he does not know how to write. He is doing this way, that way. The teacher says, "My dear boy, kindly do this way, A." So if he does it, it is nice. Similarly, we have to engage our consciousness. There is a supreme plan. Supreme plan all over the creation of the world. Supreme plan. Everything is going on under some plan. Don't you see how the sun rises exactly at the right time? How the moon rises exactly at the right time? How the seasonal changes come exactly at the time? Everything is going on under the control of the Supreme God. See a cat. No, that requires. Now if somebody says, cat, he has one, said cat, what do you use of against Satan? No. When we learn something, we have to repeat it, even in material things, and what to speak of spiritual things. Okay? So, dovetailing our consciousness with the Supreme Consciousness. I give you a small example, which is also from the Bhagavad Gita. I am not giving any example outside the purview of this Bhagavad Gita, because we are speaking on the Srimad Bhagavad Gita. Now, you will find in the Bhagavad Gita that patram pusvam phalam toyam jumi bhaktya prajacchati taya bhaktya upuritam asnami prajatatmanah. The Lord says that patram pusvam phalam toyam. Patram means a leaf and pusvam means a flower and phalam means a fruit and toyam means some liquid, water. Last word, water. If some devotee offers me these four things with devotion and with love, I accept them. Not only accept, but I eat them, you see. Now just see that here is an example that God desires to eat something from your hand. He's not one man like me that he wants some contribution for eating. No, no. He's not one man like me. He is feeding everyone. His name is Bhutabhit. Bhutabhit. Bhutabhit means one who feeds every living being. Perhaps you know it, you can practically see it. Now, besides human beings, there are innumerable living beings. If you take both, then the number of human beings will be very small all over the world. It is 4 to 80. If living, if human being, including all civilized and uncivilized, any number of whatever, Indian, American, and European, anything, take all together, they will be four parts, and all other living creatures, they will be 80 parts. The proportion is so big. But in the human society, you will find that we have got some occupation for our livelihood. Either one is doing business, or one is working, or one is engineer, one is a lawyer, or one is a daily worker. Somewhere or other, we are doing all these things for having our livelihood. But we are these only four. But in the creation of the Lord, there are other ICs, they have no such ability. Neither they are lawyer, neither they are engineer, neither they have any business, neither they have occupation, neither they make any agriculture, nothing of the sort. But they are happy. They are having their food stuff. This is a practical thing. Not only that, even a particular animal, what he likes, that particular foodstuff is supplied to. That's like a child born immediately. It cannot take anything in the world except the mother's milk. The girl, the first child born to a girl, before the child birth, there was no milk in the breast, but as soon as there is child, there is milk supply in the breast. This is nature's law. This is God's law. So practically, we have nothing to bother. Simply, we have to walk according to the direction of the Supreme. So far the animals are concerned, they are also working. But working with the help of the nature. But we go beyond the nature, because we have got better intelligence. We are not satisfied with the nature's product, but we are endeavoring to turn the nature's product by industry into some other thing, and the result is my high intelligence is being used only for the satisfaction of the body without any culture of spirit. That is the whole mistake of civilization. That I have got better understanding, I have got better intelligence than the animals, but how I am utilizing it? In the same principles of eating, sleeping, fearing, and mating. That is the samamrona of learning. That one should decide what God desires. That's all. That will make his life perfect. He should not desire anything. His desiring capacity should not be stopped. Somebody says, don't desire, become desireless. It is nonsense. Nobody can be desireless. How can we desire? Desireless. Desire is the sink of my life. How can I stop it? It's not possible. Desireless I cannot be, but I must desire, purely. That's all. I should not desire impurely. If I desire from the bodily platform of my life, then my desires will be impure. And when I shall desire as the desire of the Supreme Will. Wait, then my desire is pure. The desire has not to be cut or stopped. It has to be purified. That's all. The whole thing explained in a verse which is called Narad Pancharastra. The definition of this dog taming consciousness with the Supreme Consciousness is nicely described in two lines. Sarvapadhi vinin mukta tatparatena nirmalam rishikena rishikesa sevanam bhaktirishyat. Sarvapadhi vinin mukta. Now, this body means a designation. This body, designation. What are you, Mr. Sassan, sir? What is your nationality? I am American. What do you do? I am this thing. These are all my designations. Due to this body, designation. So, Narada Pancharatra says that one should be free from the designation. That means your consciousness. As soon as I understand that I am not this body, body is acting through my consciousness, if I am firmly convinced, if I stand steadily on this conviction that I am consciousness, then all my designation at once go. So, sarvapadhi vinin muktam tat paratena nirmala. Now, simply to become free from the bodily consciousness of life is not, but that consciousness should be made purified, just like to stop the symptoms of fever or decreasing the degree of fever is not all. Suppose a man is suffering from fever, doctor gives his medicine, now the fever decreases and he comes to normal temperature. That is not all. That diseased man must get up from that bed and engage himself in the healthy activities. Then that is the real cure of disease. Simply, therefore, to understand that I am not this consciousness, I am not this body, I am pure consciousness, that is not cure. You must have to engage your consciousness in pure activity. Sarvapadhi vinin muktam tatparatena nirmalam rishikena rishikesa sevanam. Rishikesa is the name of the Supreme Lord. Rishik means the senses. And Isha means the Lord. So Rishikesha, combined to it. This is called Sandhi combination. So Rishikesha means the Supreme Lord. We should understand that our senses, these senses which are using, this hand, this leg, this eye, this ear, this is all rented, just you have a rented car. This senses actually begins to the Supreme Lord. Because he sees, therefore he can see. Just like in the Vedic literature, you will find that jat chakshuri susabita sakala grahana raja samasta sudamutti rasi sutija jatsabhaya brahmati sambhidakala chakru govindamadi purisam tamaham majami. Now, this sun is described here. Jat chakshuri susabita sakala grahana Raja. Now this sun planet is the king of all planets. But what it is? It is the eye of the Supreme Lord. Now just imagine, we have got eyes, but unless the Lord sees with the eyes of the sun, our eye has no meaning. No meaning. If there is no daylight, then our all pride of having it too. One pair of eyes, everything finished. We must have light. And that light is by the Lord. So in every respect, therefore Lord is called Rishikesh. Our senses, they are actually the property. Property. I think, I've got this hand. I move this way. All right. So I move this way. This is my hand. I can do this way, that as I like. No, I cannot do it. as soon as the hand is paralyzed, you cannot do anything. You claim your hand that this is my hand, but when your hand is paralyzed, you cannot move it. That individual consciousness is unable to do anything. So therefore you must know the indispensable which you have got, for which we are so much proud, and by the enjoyment of the senses we are trying to be happy. Those senses belong to the Supreme Lord. Therefore, the best thing is that we should apply the senses in the service of this proprietor. We should not apply the senses for our individual satisfaction. That is the difference between material plane and spiritual plane. That's all. You haven't got to stop your senses, stop your desires. No. Simple thing, that instead of applying them for your personal desire, you should dovetail it to the supreme desire. That is our perfect life. That is our perfect life. Just like the same example which I was trying to give. Now, the Lord says that patram pusam phalam tuyam jumi bhakta pijitsiri paya bhakta abhitam masnami pijitat. Now, my devotee, now this patram pusam phalam tuyam has been specifically mentioned by the Lord because it is universal. It is universal. If a man says that, all right, Lord wants to eat from me, but I am poor man, what I can give Lord for eating? No. Even if you are a poor man, the poorest man, these four things you can collect. One leaf, little water, one fruit, and one flower. Any poor man. Of course, and in the city like New York, it is very difficult. But in India, it is not at all difficult. Because mostly they live, 90% of the population, they are villagers. So any villager, if he goes to another villager, "Sir, I want some flowers for worshipping God." "Oh, take it. Immediately." Nobody. In your country also, nobody will deny that. But here in the city, there is no flower at all to collect. If you go to the florist, then I have to pay. No, that's a different proposal. But actually, in ordinary course of life, nobody is bereft of these four. But one thing, when we stand on the supreme in my consciousness platform, you must know these consciousness platform and the dovetailing of consciousness to the supreme consciousness, the whole thing based on love, pure love. Just like a small child offers his broken biscuit to the father, "My dear father, you just taste it very nice." "Oh, father, so it is very nice? All right, give me." That a small particular biscuit is nothing for the father. But the father sees, "Oh, my child is so loving, that he has taste this is good and offering me." This is the consideration of love, exchange of love. So God is not poor, neither he is wanting for you. He is self-satisfied. He is satisfying many, many living creatures like me. So he does not require anything from you. It is for your sake. It is for your benefit that you should offer it. Now this is doctrine. "Oh, God wants to eat from me. Now why shall I not give him something to eat? Is it very difficult?" Similarly, in every sphere of your life, you can doctor. You can doctor. Instead of thinking of that I shall eat, if you think that God shall eat, so your eating process will not be stopped. But that simply by thinking that God shall it, you shall not tell your desire of discipline. God wants to eat from you and you want to give him eating. So your desire and God desires is perfect. You become perfect. Similarly, in every state, we can change our present activity, dovetailing, our present consciousness, dovetailing the supreme consciousness, and the result will be, if you go on practicing like that, then what will be the result? Now, the result is, karmajang buddhi jaktahi phalam tatta manisina janavandha vinun mukta padangachanti anamayam. If you practice in your life while you are a human being, if you utilize your life in that way, then at the end, when you give up this body, you go back to Godhead for eternal life, eternal bliss, eternal knowledge, and live happily without any material misery. That is the result. It is very difficult to stop killing our consciousness with the supreme consciousness. Not at all. Not at all. No sane man will say that it is a very difficult problem. Oh, this God. You eat? Yes. So God wants to eat something, why don't you offer it first to God? Then eat. No, if God takes it away, then how shall I eat? No, God will not take it. We are offering daily, after preparing our food, daily to Krishna. There is witness, Mr. Paul. We offer Krishna, but Krishna does not take it. Whole thing, we eat. Anyway, he does not regard. He eats. But because his spiritual eating is that, even after his eating, the whole thing is there. Purna sapurna madaya, purna maiva vasishyati. So we shall not suffer a pinch if we dovetail our desires with discipline law. Simply, we have to learn the art, how to dovetail. That's all. And some of the instances I have already cited to you, just for the matter of eating. Similarly, now, it is not only eating, the fighting also. Fight. You are a fighting man. Oh, then, after getting instruction of Bhagavad Gita, he changed his attitude, he would not fight. He says, yes, I shall fight. Now, this is the thing. The fighting man remained. The fighting man did not change into an artist or a musician. No. He did not change. You are fighting man, you remain a fighting man. If you are a musician, you remain a musician. If you are a medical man, you remain a medical man. Whatever you are, you remain. But God tells it. God tells it. So, the whole perfection is that we are all active in some department, that is a fact. Now, if our activities become dovetailed with the supreme desire and he is satisfied, then Sansiddhi, that is our perfection. Sanusthitasya dharmasya Sansiddhi haritosanam. Very nice. Sanusthitasya dharmasya Sansiddhi haritosanam. Everyone is engaged in some sort of occupation, a particular type of occupation. Nobody is free from occupation. Everyone. But what is the perfection of that occupation? Now, Sansiddhi Haritosanam is, by that activity, the Lord is satisfied. That is perfection. If by my eating, the Lord is satisfied, then that is my perfection. If by my fighting, the Lord is satisfied, then that is my perfection. So every sphere of life, we have to know whether the Lord is satisfied. That's all. That technique we have to learn. Otherwise, it is as easy as anything. We have to stop creating our own thoughts and own plans, we have to take the plans, perfect plans, from the Supreme Lord and then execute it, then that becomes the perfection of our life. Thank you very much.